You're making history. You're the first, I wish the senator from Idaho could hear this, you are the first nominee for a vacancy on the Supreme Court to be considered after July 1st of the election year. In fact, you're the first nominee to ever be considered in the midst of an election. I don't know if that has ever happened before. It certainly hasn't in modern history. And the obvious question is why? What's the hurry? Why couldn't we wait to the end of November or December or even January after leaving a vacancy on the court for 10 months after Anton Scalia's passing? Well, because there is a political agenda here. And whether you are privy to it, part of it, notwithstanding, it has to do with the Affordable Care Act. November 10th is the absolute date they have to fill the vacancy if the president and those who support him and those who support the Republican platform are going to keep their promise to end the Affordable Care Act. They need that ninth justice, and that's why it has to be hurried. Unfortunately, that is the cloud, the orange cloud over your nomination as it comes before us here in the Senate Judiciary Committee. And it raises many questions. I'd like to confine my first part of these questions to what's going on across America as we meet here today. There's an election going on. People are trying to vote. And there are a lot of issues out there that are being debated and somewhat resolved or unresolved every single day. The president continues to lie about paper ballots, saying that they are fraudulent, people shouldn't use them. There's still long lines, unforgivably long lines, for people who just want to exercise their right to vote, the governed who want to give their consent, Senator Cornyn. There's a battle royal over the Postal Service and whether it's going to be implicated in some effort to slow down or stop ballots from being delivered. One ballot collection box in Harris County, Texas, for more than 4 million people, one box. It's pretty clear what's going on here. It's an effort to make it difficult to vote, even for those who are legally entitled. Historically, the Republican Party is starting using a tactic of discouraging voters. We've seen this, making it more difficult, reducing the period of time that people can vote early, requiring IDs even if there's no evidence of fraud, purging the rolls of names. This is all going on. So I want to confine my questions at the outset here on the question of voting. And let me start with what many people read this morning, and I did, which was a summary of one of the exchanges yesterday here in the committee. It was Senator Feinstein who said President Trump made claims of voter fraud and suggested he wanted to delay the upcoming election. Senator Feinstein then asked you, does the Constitution give the President of the United States the authority, listen closely to what she asked you, to unilaterally delay a general election under any circumstances? Does federal law? Your answer, well, Senator, if that question ever came before me, I would need to hear arguments from the litigants. Read briefs and consult with my law clerks. Talk to my colleagues. Go through the opinion writing process. You went on to say you didn't want to give off-the-cuff answers like a pundit, but rather approach matters with an open mind. Is that still your response?
Senator, I've given that response to every hypothetical that I've been asked in the hearings. And as I said yesterday, I do that regardless whether it's easy or hard. I don't do that to try to, whether the question, I mean, would be easy or hard. I don't try to do that to signal it, but I do that because it would be inappropriate for me to make a comment. And I don't think I've answered any legal hypotheticals in keeping with the Justice Ginsburg rule.
So I guess what troubles me is this. You style yourself an originalist, textualist, factualist, whatever the term is, which means you go right to the words and try to understand the words and their original meaning. And so if I change Senator Feinstein's question and didn't ask you whether the president has the authority to unilaterally delay a general election, asked you instead, does the president have the authority to unilaterally deny the right to vote to any person based on their race? What would your answer be?
Well, Senator, obviously there are many laws in effect, including the Equal Protection Clause, which prohibits discrimination on the basis of race, including the 15th Amendment, which protects the right to vote against discrimination based on race. And so there's a principle in constitutional law called external constraints. And even if one evaluates what the authority a branch might have to act, there are external constraints that press in from other parts of the Constitution. Here, it would be the 14th and 15th Amendments.
Well, of course it would. The 15th Amendment, the right of citizens of the United States to vote, shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or any state on account of race. For an originalist and a textualist, that is clear text as I see it. But when asked whether or not the president has any authority to unilaterally deny that right to vote for a person based on race or even gender, are you saying you can't answer that question?
Senator, I just referenced the 14th and 15th Amendments, the same one that you just repeated back to me, that do prohibit discrimination on the basis of race in voting. So as I said, I don't know how else I can say it, the Constitution contains provisions that prohibit discrimination on the basis of race in voting.
But whether a president can unilaterally deny, you're not going to answer yes or no.
Well, Senator, you've asked a couple different questions about what the senator, what the president might be able to unilaterally do, and I think that I really can't say anything more than I'm not going to answer hypotheticals.
It strains originalism. If the clear wording of the Constitution establishes a right and you will not acknowledge it.
Well, Senator, it would strain the canons of conduct, which don't permit me to offer off-the-cuff reactions or any opinions outside of the judicial decision-making process. It would strain Article 3, which prevents me from deciding legal issues outside the context of cases and controversies. And as Justice Ginsburg said, it would display disregard for the whole judicial process.
So then let's take it to the case we've discussed before, Cantor versus Barr.
Okay.
Your 37-page dissent in this case.
Mm-hmm.
And yesterday, the junior senator from Missouri, in attempt to rehabilitate the witness, asked you, you never say that the right to vote is somewhat secondary or less than any other right. Is that fair to say? And you answered, yes, that is fair to say. I never said that. I have read and reread this. I'm not ready for a question on the final, but I've read and reread your dissent on this. I'd like to read to you what you wrote on this very question asked by the senator from Missouri. In sum, well, I think we need to establish what this case is about for those who may not know or remember. Ricky Cantor was a con man, lived in Wisconsin. He manufactured some kind of shoe insert, a pad, and tried to sell it to people who had diabetes or some foot problems. He wanted the Medicare to say that it was approved. They didn't. He sold it anyway and made that representation. When it was all over, it came crashing around him. He cheated Medicare out of $375,000. He was found guilty of a count of mail fraud, paid $300,000 in penalties and fines. He paid out $27 million in a civil settlement and then spent a year in federal prison. So this was not some run-of-the-mill miscreant. This was a fellow who was a con artist. He came to the federal courts and said, this is unfair. I've served my year in prison. Now I want to buy a gun. And the law says I can't buy a gun if I'm guilty of a felony. And the court said, sorry, Ricky, you can't buy a gun because you are guilty of a felony. Even the Heller decision. Justice Scalia said that felonies and mental illness could continue to disqualify a person from buying a gun in this country. Two out of three judges who heard this case said, that's right, that's the law. Sorry, Ricky, no AK-47 for your birthday. But then you took a look at it and reached the opposite conclusion and did extensive research and delving into history about whether or not violent felonies should be distinguished from regular felonies. And you concluded that you believed that a person who has just been found guilty or convicted of a felony should not be disqualified from their Second Amendment rights, that should be confined to those who were dangerous, guilty of a violent felony. Here's what you said to go to the question that was asked by the senator from Missouri. Here are your words. In sum, the available evidence suggests that the right to arms differs from rights that depend on civic virtue for enjoyment. The Second Amendment confers an individual right intimately connected with the natural right of self-defense and not limited to civic participation. By the very terms of the civic rights argument then, the right to arms would have been treated differently than things like the right to vote or sit on juries. So here's what it boils down to. After Heller, after the decision, after Scalia's statement, you concluded that any felony can take away your right to vote, but only a violent felony can take away your right to purchase an AK-47.
Why? Senator, with respect, that's distorting my position. What I said in that case, which is what Heller said and which is conventional in all discussions of this, to my knowledge, is that the right to vote is fundamental. However, it is an individual fundamental right that we possess, but we possess it as part of our civic responsibility for the common good. The same thing is true, for example, of jury service. Whereas individual rights, and this is again a distinction that's drawn in case law, individual rights benefit more the individual. And the entire dispute in Heller was that the majority thought that the Second Amendment was an individual right, and the dissent thought it was one that was a civic right, that was a right that people possessed, but they possessed for the benefit of society by participation in the militia. And it is a distortion of the case to say that I ever said that voting is a second-class right. That's simply not what that passage means.
But the very terms of the civic rights argument then, the right to arms, would have been treated differently than rights like the right to vote. And let's get down to the bottom line here. Heller did establish the individual right. When you finished with your dissent, here's what it came down to say. If you are guilty of a felony that is not violent, you can lose your right to vote, but you can't lose your right to buy a gun. Am I wrong?
Senator, Cantor had nothing to do with the right to vote. The point that I was making in that passage, the 14th Amendment actually expressly allows for states to deprive felons of the right to vote. And my point was that there was no similar language in the Second Amendment. I don't have an opinion and have never expressed one about the scope of a legislature's authority to take away felon voting rights. What I said is that there was a history of such provisions in state constitutions and in the federal constitution, but I did not intend, and if my words communicated that, it was a miscommunication. I have never denigrated the right to vote.
And I think it was, at best, a serious miscommunication. I'd like to read to you, in this very room, in 2005, an exchange that took place between Senator Kennedy and Judge Roberts. Senator Kennedy said, "Let's start with the Voting Rights Act. Most Americans think that the right to vote is among the most important tools that they have to participate in our democracy. You do agree, don't you, Judge Roberts, that the right to vote is a fundamental constitutional right?" Judge Roberts says, "It is preservative. I think of all other rights. Without access to the ballot box, people are not in the position to protect any other rights that are important to them. And so I think it's one, as you said, the most precious rights we have as Americans." Do you understand why I read your lengthy dissent here, where somehow or another you could say to Ricky Cantor, "Sorry, you can't vote anymore, but buy any guns you wish. We treat those rights differently." Can you see why that would be troubling based on what Justice Roberts said?
I don't, actually, Senator Durbin, because I've expressly testified here that I think voting is a fundamental right, and I didn't say to the contrary in that dissent.
Well, I read it otherwise, and I read it and reread it, so I won't get that right on your final, but I will tell you, from the way I see your language, it is explicit. You have two categories of rights, one that's independent, or one that's individual, and another that is based on collective action, as in juries, as in voting as a group in the populace. And you've made a distinction there that I think is hard to understand, difficult to explain, and inconsistent with what Justice Roberts told us at this point. I'd like to move on to another. Leave it open. I want you to have the last word on this, please.
No, I'm happy to answer whatever questions you have.
Well, let me go to the poster behind me and introduce you to another family. This week I shared two stories of what's at stake with this, your nomination, ahead of the November 10th oral arguments in California versus Texas, which will decide the future of the Affordable Care Act. This is a family, and included in it is Jared Ray of Buffalo Grove, Illinois. He's on the right. Earlier this year, Jared, 20 years old, began experiencing serious headaches. After a month of suffering, he asked his father, Mike, to take him to the emergency room. A CT scan revealed a mass on Jared's brain, immediately transported to Evanston Hospital for surgery. Weeks later, they learned the devastating news. Jared was diagnosed with medulloblastoma, a cancerous brain tumor on the cerebellum. I'm sorry to say it's one we're familiar with here in the Senate. Senator McCain suffered from a similar situation. Post-surgery, Jared began an aggressive six-week proton radiation protocol, currently on first round of eight chemotherapy treatments at Lurie Children's in Chicago. His treatment costs have now added up to $700,000 and continue. Fortunately, the ACA permits Jared to remain covered by his mom's health insurance until the age of 26. That law also ensures no lifetime limits on her policy so that they can continue to give Jared the treatment that he wanted and needs. When sharing her son's story, his mom, Mary, said, "Any parent would be shocked and terrified in this situation. If the ACA is abolished and if my employer elects not to offer coverage for dependents up until age 26, that puts Jared at risk of being uninsured and uninsurable because he will clearly have a pre-existing condition." Jared's father added, "Jared would not have access to this type of care if it were not for the Affordable Care Act because he wouldn't be insured. It's been a huge benefit." Judge, last week in your prepared testimony, you said, quote, "The policy decisions and value judgments of government must be made by political branches elected by and accountable to the people. The public should not expect courts to do so, and the courts should not try." Well, thankfully, Judge, the political branches elected by the people passed and enacted the Affordable Care Act. The problem is now that the Republicans are doing everything they can to take away this protection, and they can't do it through elected officials. They tried over and over and over in the House and in the Senate. And I mentioned Senator McCain earlier in this statement. I'll never forget it, and neither will any of us who were on the floor that night when he walked through those doors at 1:30 a.m., voting no and saving the health insurance of 23 million Americans and protections for 100 million or more. They couldn't repeal the Affordable Act in Congress. Now they've taken it to the Supreme Court. It isn't a casual decision. This administration decided that instead of defending an existing law, they would attack an existing law, along with the Republican attorneys general who've gathered for this purpose. They have good reason to believe they are going to be successful. As I mentioned yesterday, right-wing judicial activists have repeatedly stepped in to overturn decisions of the elected branches of government, activist judging, including rolling back campaign finance laws in Citizens United and voting rights protections away in Shelby County. The tool of choice of these activists is a supposedly neutral judicial philosophy of originalism and textualism, which gives judges the ability to substitute their own judgment for the elected branches and to strike down and restrict laws that are disfavored by powerful special interests. President Trump has been open in acknowledging that he wants a nominee on the court to strike down that ACA. You have said you have not made any agreements or statements to the contrary, but I will tell you, it is a cloud over your nomination, because he has over and over again. He's nominated other such advocates of originalism and textualism to carry out his political purposes. I'm afraid of the impact of that repeal on people like Jared. So we've been said that we've been told that you're following the Ginsburg rule, no hints, no previews, no forecast. In fact, during your confirmation hearing, Justice Ginsburg did answer substantive legal questions about matters that might come before the court, such as the right to choose. Yesterday, you had one notable and selective departure from your interpretation of the Ginsburg rule. When it comes to California versus Texas, the Republican challenge to the Affordable Care Act, you repeatedly claim that the deciding question in the case is severability, not the individual mandate. That's a legal opinion. But the court will only reach the severability question if it first finds that eliminating the penalty for the individual mandate rendered the individual mandate unconstitutional. Isn't that right?
Senator, what I meant by that is that even if the mandate is unconstitutional, severability would, if it is severable, then the statute would stand. And so if the mandate is constitutional, then yes, the law would stand. But I said that the emphasis, and I've gotten a lot of questions about severability for this reason, and much of the commentary in the legal news about this is focused on severability, because it means that whatever the holding is on the mandate, the severability question is the one that would be determinative even if the mandate were held unconstitutional. So it's a descriptive. I didn't say how I would rule on severability, and I didn't say whether I would interpret the zeroed out provision to be a penalty rather than a tax.
But you see, that second part, penalty, tax, You've already addressed that, haven't you?
No, I haven't. The writing that I've done before that I assume you're referring to addressed a different position, provision that wasn't zeroed out. This is now an amended provision, so it's a different provision before the court.
But you're on record for criticizing Chief Justice Roberts' opinion that the individual mandate is constitutional, haven't you?
I am on record saying that I thought that the majority opinion was a less plausible interpretation of the statute than that of the dissent. Again, that was an academic writing, number one. Number two, it was on different issues than those are presented in California versus Texas. And number three, I think you're suggesting that I have some hostility to the ACA, which I assure you that I don't. And I think, Senator Durbin, there's actually something you and I agree on here. Judicial activism is bad from either side. And no matter what somebody's policy preferences are about the ACA, I completely agree with you. They shouldn't be trying to undermine the policy that Congress enacted. So you and I agree on that, and I embrace that view of a judge's role wholeheartedly.
Thanks, Judge Barrett.